So, good evening around the world. It's 6 p.m. Yeah, it's 6 p.m. and we will start with my session GDPR. Don't be afraid. My name is Raphael Kölner from Germany, and I'm MVP for Office Server and Services and Windows Insider MVP. And now, don't be afraid. I don't want to sing now. This is Daryl's part and the part of my MVP colleagues. But in the case of the time, I will start with my little introduction. And yeah, my name is Raphael Kölner. I'm working some months ago for a Microsoft partner, the IT system house Bechtle in Cologne, and also I'm a candidate to become a lawyer for IT law next year. And I'm working at lawyer at a law firm. And also a member of, for example, the German Association of Law and Informatics, FIVE International Association of Law and Informatics. And this is a very, very interesting topic. And yeah, I'm on the one hand the IT and geek guy for IT technology for the future, like. I'm community guide for the Azure Meetup Cologne, for the Office 365 community in Germany, the Windows Insider community here in Germany, or I founded a startup, Industrial Holographics, with Andreas and Christian, to MVP friends. So I'm the IT guy on the one hand. On the other hand, I'm the law geek, or the IT law geek. And I'm blogging about it. I have podcasts. I'm on IT conferences, like I'm on law conferences. And if you have any questions, please contact me on Twitter or send me an email on Facebook, LinkedIn, Thing. Or if you have any questions in these session, please use the chat. And yeah, thank you to the organizer that you organized this, and to Mark and all of the team. So let's start. Let's start with the agenda. I hope you remember this is the agenda from the website, and I don't change it. But we will have some different topics in this session, and we talk with Mark and talk with other MVPs. Okay, let's make a basic GDPR session. What is the GDPR? What are the issues? Some part of how Microsoft do with GDPR, what they did, and all of the information. So I have a link list at the end of the session with all of the links. They are public, and I'm working with Microsoft in this area. So go forward with the typical lawyer thing. That's the books. We have some electronic databases, but if you want to have information, you need books, and you have to buy books. And I think I have all of these. No, I have to look in my. I have all of these books and some newer ones, and I read a lot of these books. Some are only for searching something special, but the most of the books I read I have here. And I have a lot of more books about this topic, but this is a lawyer or geek lawyer typical thing. So don't be afraid. Ask your trusted lawyer or ask me if you have any questions, or if you have any ideas or like this. So these are the books out of also of the German perspective as an example. And we have some English version. I know some books out of French. So if you need a book in your language, please ask me. And yeah, what I have to say, the German books are very good, because some of the guys, they work into the GDPR, are the German ones, and a lot of the law comes from Germany. And so yeah, these are the basic books for GDPR, and we have a lot of more. And if you have a look at the authors, these are the typical ones. If you are familiar with the IT law, you know the names like Herting, Goller, or Moss, for example. Then you know it. Okay, these are the data privacy guys in Germany, and they announced a lot of books and texts and versions. And so yeah, let's start. But one attention, some of these books are very old from last year. That's very old for GDPR. And yeah, buy books out of this year or wait for the second version of these books. Yeah, I don't know really an electronic database actually every time, but yeah, these are the basics. So, a little bit faster. The introduction. We will start with data privacy. Data privacy. What does it mean in Europe? What is data privacy? And it's very interesting. It's a rule, or the target is to save the residents, to save the citizen, in their with their personal data. And yeah, how and when. When we work with the data or the processing of the data, and at first we have the ban of processing of personal data. And this is what you find also in the GDPR, what you find in the member states of the UK. If you want to work, the first no, it's forbidden. But it's allowed if we have some rules, if we have some legal regulations, or we have a lot of example out of the case law, we can say, okay, these are the rules, these are the things we can processing data in our company, for example, or we can processing data for our customers. And yeah, these rules are different or not? No, they aren't different to the GDPR, the most of them. The most of them are implemented into the GDPR, and so we have a look at Article 5 and 6. And 6 is similar, 6A to F. And 4, we have 1, 2, 3 things where we say, okay, for example, we have here you ask your customer, or you ask your employee that you work with his or her personal data, and they yes, say yes. But this is not the best option. Because if you have to ask, or if you ask your employee or your customer, they can say no, and then you can't process with the data. So, see, most things we process data in the EU and Germany too. It's based on the legal things, like if you are an employee for your employer, and the employer wants to send you money, they need your name, they need your finance data, and then they work on the contract and on a legal base with his personal data, and that's fine. And we have a third one that we have, for example, a contract between all of the employees and the employer in the company, and all of this is processing and transparent. And in the future, in the GDPR, you see A to F is more than 1, 2, 3, and then A, B, C. No, we have more. Attention to number F. F is all or nothing. I said everything. So, if you read the announcements, if you read the literature to this article, if you read have a look into the books to this article, it's not really clear what we can do here, or what we can work with personal data in these cases. So it's a paragraph all or nothing, and we will ha what we have to wait for case for cases and for decisions. And then we have case law, and then we say, okay, this case is exactly what we can do under GDPR. And this is also a little issue on the transformation of GDPR to the national laws. It don't have to, because the GDPR is a full harmonization of in all EU member states, and don't have to translate it into the national membership laws. But all of the memberships does it and will do it, because they have sometimes different rules in their national law. So they say, okay, the GDPR is in front of, it's before our national rules. So we transferred, and we are compliant with GDPR, and our law will comply with GDPR. Okay, this to data privacy, for the switch from the national law to the GDPR, and GDPR to the national law. And what's personal data? Personal data can be all, and it's you can base, and you can say, okay, personal data are these data if you can find someone based on this data, or if you have information you can Say, okay, this is person A, this is person B, this is person X. And for example, we have a customer database. It's really clear. We have feedback forms filled out by customers. You have email content, pictures, IP address, HR database. All of this are personal data. For example, you have a Skype for Business implementation. They work with personal data. You have Azure AD, Azure AD Connect, and all of this working with personal data. So you have to be compliant with GDPR, also with the national laws. We have a lot of current affairs. This is only very short. I extract some of these points in the next slide. So we have current affairs on the EU and the EU Commission, the EU memberships. We have the federal current affairs for the federal government. For example, here in Germany, the IT, for example, here the IT security law, which implemented the security law for critical infrastructure. Like power companies or like this, we have the implementation of GDPR, I told you before. And also we have very big jurisdictions with a lot of topics, like here the network enforcement law, or you see the first points, the interference liability. I think this is a fifth or sixth version, or yeah, trying to make a rule or make a law that is fine. That is fine for the judges, and yeah, we will see. And so yeah, we go forward in this short time. Okay, the first one I extract is Privacy Shield. I hope you remember it's. Started, you see on the left side. Okay, I will use this here. You will see on the left side in the beginning of 2016, and here it will replace the Safe Harbor contract between the EU and the US Trade Commission, and the privacy is also a contract between the EU and the EU member states, EU Commission and the US Trade Commission. And based on these contract, or based on these kind of law, you can work with the US company, for example, can process data from a citizen out of Europe. This is based, for example, if you go into the technical area, you have some Azure functions that are based on Privacy Shield. Yammer at first was based on Safe Harbor and Privacy Shield and EU model clauses. And the most of the function placed on the EU model clauses was the next slide. And if you have a look to other cloud provider, most of them based on Privacy Shield. And we have to the end of the Safe Harbor case and the European Court, we have a long list with five core topics that Safe Harbor have to delete it because, for example, only a short example, because the national data privacy authorities can't control it, or they say, okay, the European citizens don't have the same chances to go to the US court and get their rights, for example. And so these are the points that Safe Harbor will delete it. And then we have some weeks later, 8 weeks later, on the we see it here on February 2016, we have the next one, the Privacy Shield, and they have some better points, but we have a huge discussion in Germany and the EU in Brussels about the privacy, and say, okay, there are only some points, not all points of the European Court are finished and are clear here. So we will see. The Privacy Shield is also with a new case in the European Court, and yeah, we will say what the European Court will tell us. And for example, Professor von Danwitz, one of my professors, he was a professor of mine, and he's a German judge, and he works with all of the topics of Privacy Shield and data privacy and all this. So we will see in the next weeks what happened. What happened more? We have the next case with the EU mobile clauses, and based on the Facebook case, and there we have two more cases. So the European Court of Justice also reviewing the EU model clauses, and these parts I told you is part of the cloud risk analysis. You have to go before into the cloud, and you have to do it while you use cloud computing. But yeah, this is in a review process, and also we will see what happened. In my personal view, we don't have a high risk. Because if you have a look into the GDPR, for example, the EU model clauses are the default rules how you can work with the USA, or you can work with the USA as a third party member, which isn't really good or really safe with data privacy on the same level like the EU. And yeah, but we will see what happened. The case is on the European Court and is on review. And yeah, we will see, but I don't, it's not highly risk. There's risks here, and I think the Privacy Shield is more risky than the EU model clause, but we will see. You have the case, and you get the links, so you get the informations. One more case now, in the US internal, but with connection to the EU and connection to Ireland through Microsoft data center. I hope you remember. This is a case between Microsoft and the United States and national authorities. And 2014, national authority comes to Microsoft and said, "Okay, we want data out of a Hotmail inbox from a customer, and the inbox is stored in the data center in Ireland, the Microsoft data center in Ireland." And Microsoft said, "No, it's not in the US territory. We can't give you the data from the customer based on the Stored Communication Act or the Electronic Communication Privacy Act." And then the national authority said, "Okay, we go to the judges, and we have the first round." And the first round, the judge says, "Okay, the US are right, and the US national authorities are right. Microsoft have to give the data out of a data center out of the USA to the US national authorities." And Microsoft said, "Okay, that can't be realistic. That can't be there. That's US law. US aren't available or are guilty in the Europe, for example, in Ireland." So we have a second round, and the second round, the decision is for Microsoft, and the judge said, "Okay, no, based on these rules, these US rules, they don't have to share the data, the customer data, with the national authority." Then we have a third step, and the third step in the middle of this year, in the beginning of this year, in April, and say, "Okay, no, the decision is for Microsoft. They don't have to share, cloud provider don't have to share data that's stored out of the US territory." And now, yeah, the last round, or the final round, is the based question, if it's possible that national authority get data out of that comes out of the US territory. And now we have a Supreme Court decision that they said, "Okay, we will decide about this question," and you get an answer, and in the end you see the link. Now look here, you see the link, and there's a decision that the Supreme Court will talk about it, and we will have a decision, an end decision for this question. And yeah, we will see what happened here. Have a look on my blog and you will see what happened. And yeah, one of the new slides, so I have to make the recording, or I have to make the session more than one time. We have the Department of Justice. I hope you know it. All of the American citizens will know it. And for the Europeans, okay, this is the Department of Justice, and from the USA, and they created new rules for US company to have to share customer data to the national authorities, and they make stricter rules. Okay, we have the law, that's fine, and we have stricter rules to use this law for the national authorities. And this is based on also on a case from Microsoft and the US that say, okay, we have to fight against here because if you have a look into the into the case, Brechner says, okay, into the case, we can talk about it. In an 8 month period, there are 2,567 questions from national authorities. They say, okay, don't contact the customer, don't tell the customer anything, we need the data, and please give us the data, and they have to share the data, and 68% of these questions, of these orders, there are no limit to tell the customer that the national authorities get the data from Microsoft. And without limit, for example, there's a question, okay, in 6 months you can tell it's a customer, and 68% you don't have to tell. So the most of them you don't have to tell the customer. This isn't very good for the trust of the cloud provider, for example. And so the Microsoft and other cloud provider fight here, and Microsoft have a case. And if you read the main point of this blog post from Beth Smith, this is the first step. This is another step to privacy, to data privacy, to privacy and free expression. And Microsoft will do more to cloud for good, or to help here, and to be a company that you trust in. So they work, and they I think they will talk about this case in the next months. One more very short. We have Trump executive orders, and have a look at it. For example, in January, it's finished today, but have a look in January of this year. We have an executive order for privacy, for the Privacy Act. So they say, okay, the agencies have the privacy data or the privacy policies, and it's only for person. Or only for the citizen in the USA and the resident, permanent resident, and not out of. So for European guys, no. So that can't be an issue. That have to be in the cloud risk management. But please have a look, or go on my website blog, or ask your lawyer. Please, keep it in mind. You have to look at it. One more. One of the things that a lot of people forget is the e-privacy regulation, and we will get it. I think we will get it in the next months. And if you have a look at the EU Commission website, and if you have a look into the regulation here, the main points. I don't want to read all the points. We'll have a look, we will get it, and we will get it at the same time as GDPR, and we have to combine it. And this is, for example, very interesting for Yammer, for Skype for Business, and all of this. And I'm working currently for a lot of companies. They say, okay, we will get the privacy regulation, we get GDPR, what we have to do, what happened. And this is in the context of, we have a change from the classical communication, like short messages, phone calls, to newer communication with WhatsApp, Facebook, Skype for Business, and we have the same shift in the companies. That's what we do every day. So we need, or they discuss the broad regulations. For example, if you have a look at the book announced 2 years ago, they say, okay, we need the same regulation for new tools like Skype for Business or web apps, like we have for the typical telephone calling. And we will see. This is around the over the top services, and it will come. And there are more rules, or there can't be the same rules for the same service like the classic services. And please don't forget it. Look at the fact sheet, look at the website, and do it with your GDPR together, and change the processes, and keep it in mind. So GDPR, We start 5 minutes, 6 minutes, like this, about GDPR, and then we have to go to the Microsoft, what Microsoft do. And at first, GDPR and data privacy. We have the European Commission, the EU Parliament, the Council of Europe. They work with data privacy, they work with the announcements, they work with the draft of the law regulations, and also the Article 29 Working Party. Have a look at their website. They have a lot of explained, and they decision some decisions to the data privacy, and this is the special commission they work with. And we have working groups, for example, with Jan-Philipp Albrecht, one of the out of the German party, the Green German party, and he and they worked for data privacy. And out of these working party, we have the GDPR and also e-privacy rules, and all of these are the part of the project, the digital single market. So the EU don't say, okay, we have to reorganize the data privacy. No, they have a look at the whole market and say, okay, we have cybersecurity, you have data privacy. We don't have a look at a single container on the topic. We have to look at all of these topics and put it together in the digital single market project and think about all of these topics and the influence of the topics. So that's in my position, that is the right way. And that's what, for example, also the German federal government does and did. So some historical, our data privacy law in Europe based on a very old directive from 1995. Remember the US, the US one is from 1986. So remember we have an internet connection on this year? No. So yeah, you have to think about it. It's so, for me, it's just very, very old. And in the between, we got the GDPR, we have the Council Framework Decision 2008 on processing personal data in the framework police and judicial cooperation. We have a new one 2 years ago, that we can share this data with the US government. That's a new one, in the combination, or I think 2 or 3 weeks before Privacy Shield, and then we have now GDPR, and we have our new timeline that we can translate the law into the national laws to the 5th of May 2018, and 25th on the end of May 2018, the GDPR shall apply. So now we have time, and now is the time to be compliant with GDPR, to be compliant with the future. And Microsoft do and did a lot of. So in the next slides, we will see what Microsoft do. And the way to the GDPR, to tell you something about it, how heavy it was and how stones we'll find in this process. We have the EU Commission, we have the working groups, we have a lot of drafts. I'm one of the guys. They started with the first draft, and they send emails, and they are in communication with the guys. And we have, in my position, a very good one, public consultation. They ask, hey, all member or companies or association or clubs, send us our owner meetings, send us our what we have to do. These are implemented into the drafts, and we have internal consultations, and then we have it in the European Parliament, in the Council, and then we have, okay, we have the GDPR, and you have to translate it, and 2 years later, we have the GDPR, and we have a full harmonization in all of the EU member, not very full, I'll tell you later why not very full. We have 64, now we have 64 planned gaps, that the member state can fulfill. And now we are here on the part the member states have to translate and have to fulfill the gaps, the planned gaps, if they want. And remember, they have to know. We have a full harmonization with the GDPR at the end of May 2018. But if we have no issues in combination with the national law, all of the members said, okay, we have new drafts, we will be compliant with GDPR, so we don't have cases or law cases in Rust of in this area. So one of the first questions, GDPR where? In which countries? I got a little animation. In the EU member, in the EU members, we have the GDPR, and I hope Great Britain don't leave the EU. And if they leave the EU, we don't have the GDPR there. Great Britain will be a country like the USA, and we have issues with working of personal data, with processing personal data. And we will see. I read a draft out of the working Brexit working group, and they tell, okay, no, we will trust in GDPR and Great Britain will be compliant with GDPR, but if they aren't a member of the EU, we need contracts. We need a special contract with GDPR that we can work with data. So it's highly, highly risk. And I know a lot of companies that say, okay, we will leave Great Britain with our data to Dublin or to Amsterdam, to France, when we are in preview in France with Azure, or we leave to Germany, so we don't have an issue in the EU, and we don't have an issue with the data privacy, or we have more and more and more work with this if the Great Britain will leave. So these are the area. But which companies have to be compliant? Only in these member states? No. Every company, they want to sell their products, their services in the EU to European citizens. They only have a target. They don't have to sell. Only have the target to Europe, and European citizens have to be compliant with the GDPR. This is very interesting. So this is a rule that every citizen in the EU and every resident can say, okay, if we work in the EU, we have the services, the products, all of what I sell are based on GDPR, are based, and I am safe and I can work with it. So that's very interesting. That's also a reason why Microsoft do, okay, we have to transform our contracts to GDPR compliance, and very, very interesting. And if they don't do it, for example, all of the companies they don't be compliant, or they have issues, and we have a case at the national authority. They have an issue like 4% of their global earnings. So that's very much. That's more, more, more than we have today. Today we have the highly ones are 200,000 and 400,000 for Facebook. This is not much, but if you have a thing, you have an issue, and for one issue, 4% of your global earnings, that's all the companies have to do. They say, okay, we have to be compliant with GDPR. We have some myths. We have a fact sheet. All of my information based on official sources. So I have a fact sheet here in English on the EU Commission from 2012. It's more than, okay, have a look to what it means, GDPR, what does it doesn't it mean? And it means, for example, reduce the number of databases. So it's not only data privacy, security of the personal data, and not of the only the personal data, secure all the data, so cybersecurity. So you see the influence of the topic cybersecurity, for example. And one of the big things is put individual in control of their data. This was a huge decision some years ago from a national and from the European court. They say, okay, they will have to control their data. Some said, okay, the personal data are the oil in the future. So yes, okay, we can discuss about it, but back to the slide. That's what it mean. It don't mean, for example, gives the commission a blank check to regulate all or to do all. So if someone thinks that they don't understand the influence and the rule and the process between the organization of the EU and the member states. So have a look if you want to know more about GDPR. GDPR facts. That's the next one. We have general facts here. requirement transparency on the handling, limited personal data processing to specify the tape proposals. And I don't want to read all of this. These are the basic facts, or these, yeah, the key facts you have to do. You have to think about it. This is the basic, or the key facts the GDPR based on it, and the data privacy is all based on. Is it all very new? No. I'm working at some customers, say, okay, we do it today. So we only say, okay, we are GDPR compliant, and say GDPR on the paper, and that's fine. So that's okay. For example, you have to limitate the personal data in your process. So go, an example, go to Azure AD and make a Azure AD connect to your local AD. So you have to filter which attribute, which data will processing in the cloud. So don't click. So have a look. Okay, these we need, and then the data we need, we transfer into the cloud or make a hybrid tenant, for example, to understand it better. So GDPR requirements also only an example. That's what I do every day, and that's what I do with the with huge companies and little companies. That's what I do also with some of the law firms in Germany. We have some specialists like the Professor Herting from Berlin with his own company, and they are working with the customer based on requirements like this. Be transparent, for example, define rules, use encryption to encrypt your data in transit at rest to minimize your risk if you have data breaches, for example, and define process of portability of all the data of the employee. There's also one last week I defined a process for Yammer, for example, for portability of the data with a product group. So that's very interesting. You can find all of these requirements in Azure and Office 365 and all of this, but keep it in mind, it's only an example, it's only some rules. So we have the requirements, we know what it based, we know a little bit about data privacy, a little bit about personal data. There are a lot of topics, so I have only 60 minutes. So Microsoft Basics. Basics is the next topic. Microsoft Basics, what Microsoft want? Cloud for global good, I told you, and that's what Satya Nadella said some months ago, and they only said, okay, we need also we need a go cloud for global good, and also we need a gentrification for cybersecurity. That's what you said. Okay, this is a great idea, but not of the all of the member of this world will underline it. So they see the conflicts with Russia, they see the conflicts in China, they see the conflicts in India, and all of these are more conflicts on the cybersecurity area. So cybersecurity is also a big point. The big point in the Microsoft work. So that's what they want. And we have also the Microsoft Basics. This is a slide from 2010. It's 7 years old, and it's the same. It's same today. It's your data. So it's the customer. That's your data. That's your data, and you own it. You control it. You run this. We run the service only for you. That's what. The contract says you model clauses all said that's the data of the customer. Microsoft only the provider for the data, only the processing for the data. So that's also one of the bases why Microsoft have so a lot of cases with the U.S. government against the U.S. to the Supreme Court. That's the data of the customers, not our data. So if you want the data as the customer, or go the way about the law way about the judge and the decision, and then get the data from the customer. So, and then also for the processes, for their products, built-in security, privacy by design, conditionless compliance, that's what you see in the Microsoft world, what they're working on it, and also on transparent service operation. Have a look, for example, at the Microsoft Office Graph or like this, into the texts, the white papers, and you will see what Microsoft do, and you can see it, for example, in the Azure Office 365 Trust Center, turn to your tenant and extract the data. So one of my favorites, and I don't think everyone talked about it. So we see what Microsoft Basics are. We know what GDPR is. not all, only some examples. And now have a look at contracts. For example, here it's not a German cloud contract, it's a contract. And the European contract, this is a contract in real life. You know, if you sign a contract with Microsoft, you get a lot of papers, you got a lot of contracts, some different ones, EA contracts, ones that have view model clauses as a part of the online service terms, contract data processing as a part of online service terms. And you have a data, you have a contract with your Microsoft partner, for example, you have one with Microsoft Ireland, one with Microsoft Corp, and all of this. This has a sheet. We have here the customer, they have access to the data in the EU, for example, this EU customer, Dublin or Amsterdam are the primary data center, and then there's a secondary data center, and sometimes we have a connection to a US data center, for example, for Azure AD connection and for a lot of technical reasons. And so customer, for example, has an issue, they go in, they make a ticket and go into the ticket system. And then we have, for example, also contact with the Microsoft engineer from Microsoft Corp and all of this. And the licensing, for example, is a part of Microsoft Ireland. So we have different connections and we have a lot of contracts. And we have contracts based on the model clauses, or based on contract processing data and model clauses we need, for example, to work with Microsoft Corp. So outside of the USA, with out of the EU, with the USA, we need the EU model clauses, and sometimes for other contracts, we have here also the privacy shield. Have a look in it. We have the EU model clauses, and in the middle of this year, was in the last months, we have the first changes in the model clauses and we the model clauses in the Microsoft Online terms, and the model clauses don't have to change. They have to be like the same text the EU Article 29 group controlled, and this is what we have in the attachment 3, for example, here page 30-34, and we see some interesting changes here, for example, that we have the standard contractual clauses and we have the information based on GDPR, and it's a little bit clearer if you go to the next slide, the contract data processing. This is also integrated into Microsoft Online terms, and now it's integrated this new with the GDPR, for example, your personal data Article 28.1, and you will find this is a new from the online service terms. And if you have a look at GDPR, you see an attachment 4 for European Union GDPR protection terms and an appendix with additional GDPR terms. And if you open the Microsoft Online terms in Word and you search for GDPR, you will find 46 parts where GDPR is announced, and so you'll see, okay, we have now the implementation of GDPR into the Microsoft Online terms, and Microsoft are one of the first companies to say, okay, we have October, November to 2017, and we are compliant, we nearly compliant to GDPR in the next year, so they base their contracts on GDPR. Very important hint, if you want to be compliant, if you want to sign these contracts, you have to sign these contracts new. So if you have a contract with Microsoft, Office 365, Azure, and all of this, you have Microsoft Online terms. In this month, you sign the contract. So if you want these new ones, go to your Microsoft account partner, go to your Microsoft partner, or go to Microsoft, okay, I want to sign the new Microsoft Online terms with GDPR, and so we will be in this area compliant with GDPR. I think we will get a new change in the next year if GDPR rules are very clear or clearer. But these are the first Microsoft Online Service with GDPR, and so Microsoft did here a lot to implement the general data protecting regulation in their contract, and especially here in the Microsoft Online Service contract. Well, Microsoft and GDPR tools. We are talking in discussion about Microsoft and GDPR and help the customer to be compliant with GDPR. And Microsoft also want to be compliant with GDPR. You see, they change the contracts, for example. And we have two screenshots out of the Microsoft website. Okay, we want to, we explain the GDPR, and we also and develop some tools to for our customer to be compliant with GDPR. And we have, for example, here personal privacy controls and notification, transferring policies, IT and training. These are some points or changes. I don't want to say this every change, there are some points to talk about it and what they do, and also some basic information what GDPR means for your data. So we have stricter control, and you have to be transparent. You have to talk to your employees or to your customer if you have a data breach, and you have to monitor it. Best office data classification and encryption, and encrypt your email, and all of these things, and all of these tools you can use. And we have also lists with tools. It's at the end of my session. So be GDPR compliant. You don't have a chance to do not, or you get in trouble if you don't be compliant with GDPR. So the typical process of what I do every day is to discover, identify what personal data exists, where it resistance. If we have, for example, also contracts with other partners, that we have a special rule for processing data, and then how to manage all the personal data, how to manage the contract, how to accessible with an organization, and manage all of the information we have, and to define processes with personal data, to document all of this, and to protect the data, to have security controls, to use tools like Azure Information Protection, Office 365 ATP, or third party tools from different Microsoft partners, like our sponsors of this conference. And so you have to do this, or don't have to use all of these tools, but you can use a combination. But you have to do something if you don't know the information or don't encrypt today, for example. And then you have to monitor and report all of these. And these are the four steps to be compliant with the GDPR. And if you have a look at the Microsoft page, ooh, you will find these four steps too, four or five steps too. And this is really interesting. And if we go further, for example, if we have to discover, you can use, for example, the GDPR detailed assessment to start with it and say, okay, we have PowerPoint presentation with Excel files, and we can use it, and use your own Excel file, use your own documentation system, and share and catch the data and take the data, and how many and this has, and then you can work with it. Then you can decide which tool I want to use, and how to manage it. And for example, data classification is only very short here as an example. Use data classification. We have a discussion with the national authorities in Germany and with the EU Commission. Say, okay, we can say we have, for example, here, these are the best practice. We have 5 points: the public, personal, internal, confidential, and secret. You will find these also as default in the Azure Information Protection, if you want to classify the data. And we have here also examples out of the national authorities, European Commission, and all of these literature examples for the rules of the classification of data. And in my opinion, don't only classificate your personal data, classificate all of your data, included IP data, law data, the secret data. Don't have to be a combination with personal data, but please secure all of your data. And one of the tools I told you more than one time is the Azure Information Protection. You can protect, manage, and report and monitoring it. So yeah, we implemented this in a lot of companies, and with the plan two, with the highest plan for highly restricted and confidential data. We use hold your own key and also bring your own key in some cases. We use the IPs, Azure Information Protection Scanner, it's in preview. We are in TAP program and all of this and work with the team to labeling all of the data, automatic labeling and classification, also protect these. It's a combination also with Azure AD, with data loss prevention, with conditional access, and all of these configuration. You can put it together, use it, and it's a second and third step to be compliant with GDPR. You have the information and the cost. Okay, we have $5, for example, on the list price, $5 per month per user. But exactly, if you combine it from DLP and other tools, it's cheap for what you get. And I want to prefer also to use the Talos box. So you can use it, and also you have one more. You have risk on compliance tools like in SharePoint, GDPR, Activity Hub. Thanks, I read one of my MVP guys help here to create and to implement it. This is one of the great features. I see in SharePoint, for example, we have some third party tools like from FPoint or I was on a conference 2 weeks ago. There's also some third party Microsoft third party tools. I said, okay, we can give you the information for data breaches and data requests and all of this. And we have also a risk on compliance dashboard. I see, okay, how information you get, how is Microsoft control, is customer control, if you have ISO certification, action items, all of this. And this is the same if you have to automatically, this is the process. Everyone told, and also my MVP friends, use Office 365 Score. We use it on our MVP summit a few years ago. So this is one that is implemented in the new Office 365 Admin Center. You see the secure core. Okay, this one is not the best. This is one of my test tenants, and 80 is not the best, but I want to show you, for example, you have to enable MFR for global admins and your score will rise up here. And you have to think about it. You have to think about the access, who have access for what, and please documentate this. And not only use these tools, but use these tools as a first step to documentate it, to be compliant. It works in that you get the information you need, and use the tools. One of my hints, use the tools and work with a partner together to be compliant, and please work with a lawyer together, not only with a partner, and in a combination you can be compliant. And so you can make a very long list of tools you can use to be GDPR compliant. Some tools, in my opinion, you have to use. Some tools it's a kind of use, or you can use combination of these tools. So my level two is the Azure Information Protection, inclusive with Azure RMS and IAP Scanner in the public program now. And so thank you, Adam Hall, for this great product. And to classify, protect, and manage your data, and also Office 365 Advanced Threat Protection, Windows Defender, Identity Protection, Cloud App Security, Intune, all of these tools. And most of them are included in the new product, Microsoft 365. So you can speak with your Microsoft partner, okay, make up a good price for all of these tools so we can be compliant with GDPR, not be compliant only with GDPR, to secure your data and to save your knowledge in your company. This is, for me, one reason more. Save your knowledge, be compliant, work on a secure way, and you have a lot of tools. You can make combination with Microsoft third party tools, and there are a thousand ways to do and to be compliant with GDPR. You have the easy way, you have a middle, and you have a very hard working way. So speak with your competent partner and be compliant. That's the same with a lot of links here. For example, I share you, here's the central page for partner Microsoft marketing details to GDPR, that the one in the on the bottom, and here you will find a lot of information, assessment, demos, at the activity hub, for example, show the assessment and all of these information, GDPR briefing deck. And in the next, I have a lot of links and slides for you, so I will switch. I have 5 minutes now, and so we'll go forward. And here we have Azure, for example. Some days before, we have the Azure GDPR resources. They share all the information on one page. So go here, go on this website you get for Azure. In my wish, if any from Microsoft here, it was very, very cool to have a database, for example, for Azure and also for Office 365, for the apps, for the Azure products. If you have to go, say, we have, for example, cognitive services and cognitive services, the text control and analysis feature. You can say, okay, if there's ISO certification, is this GDPR compliant, can we control it, and all of this, and with a green arrow, and then it's finished. So this was really good, and I'm working with the startup phase now. So if you want to have the first information, come to me, and we will build this database so all of the customer can get very easy the information. But this attention, this is only information from Microsoft. What you do with the data, what you in the company and all of this, you have to define the process. You have to be compliant. So not only Microsoft, it's a combination and from you and Microsoft. We have also GDPR and Azure AD, for example, for EMS, for Office 365, and we have more links. We have a webinar with Julia White. It's a kind of marketing, but have a look at it. It's very cool, and yeah, that's. Please use these links. You have the little database now of links from Microsoft to GDPR, and we will see. And I will produce more and more information in the future, in combination with law companies. So yeah, be compliant. For example, Azure Information Protection, Danfostina, have two, now three or four blog posts about how to configure Azure Information Protection to be compliant with GDPR. I have a little discussion on Ignite in this year about it. So more and more Microsoft products will have these configure information, but these are also the default configure information you have to create. You have to change it and to transform it in your company. So, but it's, don't be afraid. You have a lot of material, you have a lot of tools, you have to pay for the tools, okay? But you can be compliant, don't be afraid. And the future, last minutes, the future about GDPR, in May next year, 2018, we have some open questions. In the beginning of the session, I told you we have 64 planned opening clauses. They have to be, or they can be, better, they can be filled by the member states and national law and national regulations. And we will see what they do in Germany. We have a lot of drafts. Last weekend, I read 250 pages of drafts from only Germany, and I saw something out of French, 100 pages, and from Italy, 80 pages. And but it's very cool. They are all of these pages are translated in English, so you can read it and you can see, okay, what the national member, what the member states do and what they transform. And I hope the EU Commission will make a database. I talked with them last week. I hope they will make a database so you can see, okay, we are in Spain. Which of these 64 planned opening clauses will fulfill and how? And so. Yeah, you have not a very full harmonization of data privacy in EU. They has these little planned gaps, but I think this yeah, this was the in the decisions in the EU Parliament and EU Court, the Parliament and the Council. They say, okay, we all say yes to the GDPR and the member states if we have our little gaps we can fulfill with national law. Okay, they get it, and now we have to rule with it. Yeah, with other laws and other regulations, it's influenced a lot of other Law regulation of the national law. So in Germany we will have a lot of changes in the different parts, and we will have also changes with the e-privacy directive and the e-privacy rules and all of the future. So keep it in mind, we are in the process. Don't be afraid. We ca you can be compliant. You don't have to be 100%. All of this. Have a look at the key facts, talk with your lawyer, and then it can be good. And a good hint is to be informed about the future and the current law. That's the lawyer work. Build a process, use the tools, and be compliant. That's your Microsoft partner work. But don't trust a partner without a lawyer. I have some of these partners in the last time, and yeah, that can be make issues. So only in combination. And at very last, this is the same with Global Cloud or Microsoft Cloud Germany. You can have a long discussion, but now not for you, in a very short way. Okay, if you are very highly regulated, use Microsoft Cloud Germany. But in the most of the cases, you can use the Global Cloud, the uCloud. But this is a different topic. Come into my sessions to GDPR, to Microsoft Cloud Germany. And so thank you very much for the session. 1 minute over. And if you have any question, use Twitter, use my website, use my email, contact me, and I'm also in the chat. And yeah, I'm now at an insurance, and the next meetup with the next session about GDPR. So stay tuned for you. For more great sessions, go into your room and have a great evening or a great 2 days. So, thank you very much. Bye bye from Germany.